I was gonna preempt it by, you know, just a question.
Here we go, guys. Here we go. Hi, everybody. Hi, hello. Good evening. Welcome to the Community Preservation Committee meeting. This is the public informational hearing. Tonight, we have on the dais, we have Gary Fowler, representative from the Select Board, Paul Nelson, representative from the Affordable Housing Trust, Jim Demento, representative from the Park and Rec, myself, I'm Harry Lacatillion from your Planning Board, Peter Burns from your Open Space Committee, and Rachel Bancroft from the Conservation Commission. There are a couple of members missing, but we'll try to keep going with it, and we'll make it all happen. You're probably all familiar with the way the process works. Tonight is the public informational hearing. The board, over the last few months, has decided and recommended to town meeting certain projects that came forth before us, and tonight we're here to present them for us, for everybody, so you can tell. The CPA has three core categories, which is community housing, historic preservation, and open space. You've probably seen this a thousand times. Every year, we have to reserve or appropriate 10% of the funds that come in for the three core categories. Once the reservations are made, then the townspeople at town meeting up or down and say whether they like it or they don't. This year, as we have for the last few years, we'll be asking for a certain amount of money to pay for the bond that we took out several years ago for the turf field and for the CR on Wheeler Brook Farm. We'll do that at the same time that we make the reservations for the three core categories. This year, we're recommending $150,000 for the debt service, and that will help pay for the bonds. We're ahead of the game with that. In public meetings this year, we reviewed all of the project suggestions, and we came up with what we thought was the best use of the CPA monies for the town. And now come our recommendations. The first is the community housing category project. It's the Georgetown Housing Authority ADA ramp. And why don't you come on up, Diane?
Ooh.
Introduce yourself.
I didn't know that was going to happen. Not just properly.
Oh, you look lovely.
Hi.
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 Okay.
Let me know when you want me to click over.
So this ramp was put in 1973, and we've been holding it together with cement and other whatever it is they use to fill it in. And it's just starting, it's lifting up, and it's becoming a tripping hazard now. And a lot of people use this with their wheelchairs and walkers.
Mm-hmm. Could someone do me a favor and just tap on the glass and let them know that we need to see the presentation as well? Thanks. And kill the key over? Can we kill the key over?
Oh, thanks. See what's going on.
Great. Let me know when you want to advance.
They're all pretty much the same, just different angles of the same shot, because it's all one ramp. And it goes into the community room, where we have a lot of, there we go. So that you can see there's a tripping hazard there, if someone gets their walker stuck in that. Okay.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
More tripping hazards.
Yeah, yeah.
And ultimately, now that the ramp has to be upgraded to the new ADA design standards, so it's not only repairing this ramp, the new standards I hear are different than the standards when this ramp was put in as far as the railing and everything.
The railing will have to go, yeah.
So not only are they repairing the ramp, but they have to update it to the newest ADA standards of how a ramp is built. I just want to throw
Thank
that out
you.
There. That's all.
Thank you.
At this point, Diane, I'm going to ask from the audience. This is a public hearing. It's not a meeting. It's a hearing. You're all here to ask any questions you want. Are there any questions about the ramp? And sounds like you did such a great job.
Thank you.
Describing Thank it you. That there were no questions.
Okay.
Thank you. Next is the Affordable Housing Trust grant. Paul Nelson from the Affordable Housing Trust. Let me know when you want to advance a slide there, Paul.
Good evening. Actually, the first slide should have the amount on it, too. It's kind of like, there we are.
There we go.
So we got $110,000that's actually been allocated. It hasn't been approved, but just allocated. Essentially, the Affordable Housing Trust started back in 2011. We were actually put together as almost a corporate financial entity. And this is under the auspices of the state, so the first thing you have to do almost is put together a plan to understand where you're at with your housing. So the first thing we did 2011, we were instituted. 2012, we had a housing production plan put together. And essentially, what that wants us to do is to try to create, obviously, affordable housing. And a way of doing that is to maintain the current housing that you have, which in this case is, other than Longview and Trestleway, not a whole lot, as a matter of fact. And then capitalizing the opportunities you might find to create new housing in various ways. That could be from scratch, that could be a rebuild, could be a lot of different things depending on the opportunity. And then aid in buying and renting affordable housing, so we actually can buy some things. Because we are a fiduciary organization, we can buy and sell properties and things of that nature. So we can buy, in this case, what we're doing is buying a property and renting it. We also have something called a rental assistance program that is pretty successful in town. We normally do about 8 households. We will help them with the rent. They are required to put in 30% of their income, and then we cover the rest for whatever is required. And the whole idea is a hand up, not a hand out. And so it's designed to run 2 years, and hopefully within that window we will have them up and out. Let's see, next page. And that's a picture of the housing production plan. If you can read really closely, there's a URL underneath that allow you to get to it. Actually, if you go to the town website and go to the Affordable Housing Trust and just double click on that, there will be an icon there for the production plan. And it was, like I say, put together in 2011, needs to be upgraded, but she did a heck of a job. It's really impressive. And it was actually bought off on by the town, by the selectmen. It is something that the town has bought into, although it doesn't always seem like it, but it was. Okay, next page. Let's see. Where we start out with, if you looked at the town, this was back in 2012, and I don't think it's changed dramatically. There's approximately 75 families in Georgetown right now that are actually existing below the poverty line. And I know of some specifically, so I can attest that that's probably a decent estimate. And there's also a pressing demand for all kinds of rentals. If you look at what the state is trying to do within its confines everywhere from Boston on all the way out to the western border, they need affordable rentals. A lot of families are not set up to maintain a house. They can do rent, but they can't do things like maintain a fund, so that if something goes bad, they can actually fix it. They don't have that kind of money. There's also a demand for starter homes for younger people. Right after you get out of college, what you'd like to do is find a one-bedroom place that you can, you know, kind of situate in and get established. And because you'll probably move if you go to job one. Certainly, in the earlier years of your career, you tend to move more than in the later. And then lastly, there's a demand for elderly. They would like to actually age in place. And there's a lot of different ways of doing that. We have the Pulte homes out here on North Street. There's also where they can actually fix up their homes and make them more adaptable for people with wheelchairs and things of that nature. And so here's another cut on it. This came right out of the housing production plan again. So that was 2011. And at that point in time, there were 10 family rentals, 126 senior disabled, and then there were 38 at Longview. And then there's the ownership. So that was back in 2011. And in 2014, the elderly handicap waiting list was like 71 families, households. The family waiting list was 71. It sounds funny, but they were both the same. And that was just for Georgetown. The area waiting list was about 300. And from what I understand, the waiting list has been closed because it's ludicrous. There's no sense in putting people on it. So it's not good. We have a challenge. Next, okay. So the charter actually allows for lots of things to happen. Like I say, we can buy and sell properties. We are actually buying a property to rent. We are working with Attorney Leaf people. They're building a 4-bedroom house that will be a sold as an affordable unit. And what that means is it'll probably be sold for around 70%, or they'll be purchased for around 70% of the average median income in our area. So for a three-bedroom house, that's a little over $200,000. So it's considerably less than you would have to pay right on the market. We're also, we help out on the Housing Authority periodically. Oh, she's gone. When they run out of, if something breaks at a trestle way, for them to get money from someplace like CPC, you're talking about over a year process. So what we do is we just cut them a check. We're a bank. So that helps out in that area. We're restricted to what we could do with the money. We certainly can't just give it to any Tom, Dick, or Harry, but Diane works. And let's see.
Especially not Harry.
Yeah, especially right.
Don't want to go to me.
And we actually have, like I say, the rental assistance program. Went through that. We also need to do all these kind of things. There's all kinds of rules and regulations that come from the DHCD and on the state. And so you have to buy something, to sell something, to rent something. They all have tons of paperwork. And what we don't have is skilled people that know how to do it. Currently, what we're doing is contracting with various professionals that do that. And sometimes it's reasonable and sometimes it's not. So we've been trying to develop the talent locally that we can actually do these things with. It's called a monitoring agent function. And they do lotteries, they'll do house pricing and things of that nature. But it's something we require, and it's really hard to find around here. And again, that goes along with securing the professional assistance. We actually had Martha Solich from Coastal Home Buyers, and she was excellent, but she only lasted for like a year and a half, 2 years, and now we're on our own again. So we're trying to build some talent in-house that'll have some permanency to it. And we've actually worked with Harbor Light Communities in a mass housing partnership, looking at some properties. Nothing has panned out yet, but we're working. We looked at West Street, we looked at a number of different places, but so far, like the larger places, they want to build something that's like 35 units, and around here, finding any kind of property, especially that would have the sewage capacity for like 35 units, is nigh on to impossible. So it's a challenge. Let's see. We are, like I say, adding an affordable rental, 44 Searle Street. It's a four-bedroom house, and it's only a three-bedroom house. I got that right. The three-bedroom, right. And it was totally redone. We decided to accept that property rather than a brand new one because we could turn it over quickly and we could rent it, and it would just seem like a thing to try to do. This is, again, to try to build our skills in-house. We'll try the rental and see if we can actually deal with it, because there's a lot more that goes with renting than it is selling. Selling's a piece of cake. You sell a house and it's gone. And with a rental, though, you own the thing, lock, stock, and barrel. So we'll see how it goes. If we can build the talent, that would be great. And then we're working with Mr. Olson on 40B at 34 East Main. We think that is a place, that is a 40B that we need to put through. It's in a perfect area, 40Bs with small 1 and 2 bedroom condos. Basically, you'll end up with people that may or may not have even a car, and they want to probably be able to walk to everything that they need. And you can do that from 34 East Main. It's great. We're also looking at buying some land out on Jewett Street, and we've worked with Habitat for Humanity. They've come down and taken a look at it. They liked it. Unfortunately, they're right now over their head in doing things that they're supposed to be doing in other towns, but we're on their list. And so we're looking at pursuing the property. So if we obtain it, then we'll just put it on hold until they're ready to do their job. And what we want to do is, again, it's so key to be able to get the infrastructure in place for us to be able to do our job effectively. So we're not running around in the headless chicken mode, which we do quite a bit, because it's just tough to pull together resources where you don't have the skills to understand what you're even missing. So that's one of the things we're really working on. And I think we can say with all earnestness, business is really picking up. For the first 2011, 12, 13, and 14, things were pretty slow, but now we're turning houses over. We see some other things coming in down the pike, and I think we'll be doing at least two a year going forward. And then the last page, that is 44 Searle Street. That will be a rental. That is before they actually redid the roof. They're going to be repainting all the eaves. The inside is it's bigger than my house. So I think it's really quite a property. If the renting doesn't work, it'll sell really well. Not a problem. So that's it. Any questions? Yes.
Who was in charge of the rental for the 44 Searle Street?
The Affordable Housing Trust is. You mean an individual?
Does the town now own it?
Yeah, we will very shortly. There is a woman by the name of Krista Costa. She does lotteries and that kind of thing for a living. And so she will be putting together a lottery, and people will be able to submit their application to the lottery. We're not far enough along yet to do any advertising, but she also is required to put together a pretty extensive advertising package. So anybody that's interested within this area will get the information.
And what are you anticipating on Jewett Street? Is that a one-family home?
Looking at a duplex right now. If it goes through as a 40B, there might be extra land there for a little bit more property, a little bit more building, but currently it's just anticipation of a duplex.
And you anticipate partnering with Habitat so they would build?
Yeah, it seemed like a good thing to do. They like to have the local town have some investment. And so we would probably do the land and then probably kick in some money along the side.
Do you know what our subsidized housing inventory number is right now, with a percent?
Yeah, we're about 11%, 11.5%. I looked at the list just today, and it's not quite right, but I'm not going to tell anybody. They're supposed to, they have us down for two houses on True Lane. As far as I know, there's only one down there, but I'm not going to call them and tell them.
They'll find out eventually.
So. Maybe, but it's like that for 4 or 5 years now. So, but hopefully we'll get around that anyway. I did some calculations, and if we don't do like 2 a year, 2.4 a year, I think I figured by 2020 we would be open for a hostile 40B. So we really need to keep moving.
Why isn't our inclusionary housing bylaw keeping up with that number?
Because, good question. It is right now, but there were a lot of things that happened. There was one development where the owner managed to convince the planning board that the last two houses would be affordable. He just declared bankruptcy instead and left town. So I think we're wising up. I think we do things a little bit smarter now. So that's unfortunate.
What
yes.
project was that?
It's off Warren Street. I forget what they called it now.
Raymond's Court.
Yeah.
Oh, Raymond's and Pine.
Raymond's Court, yeah.
Yeah, Raymond's Court, Sage, yeah. All those streets off of Warren.
Something like 40 houses, something like that, of 40 units. Because there's a elderly housing back there too. But we got Zippo out of it. But that's,
isn't there some recourse by the planning board decision or covenant?
I don't think there is. I don't know of any recourse, Harry.
No, the unfortunately the at the time I guess the it was before my time. We just sort of ended up cleaning up the mess. It was put off and put off and put off for so long that the developer, the last two houses that actually got developed were supposed to be the affordable housing units. It got too late. The developer claimed bankruptcy, and at that point, unfortunately, what happens is the town is not subordinate to the mortgage. The bank has the first dibs on it. The bank takes all the property, and then they auction it off so that they can make their money.
Have lessons been learned here?
Oh, absolutely. Now the decisions
yeah.
are
well,
much
Leaf is
better
a good,
time.
Yeah, Turney Leaf is a good example. We're getting our two houses out of there.
Oh, yeah.
So it's I think we're a little smarter.
Yeah. And nothing, and the properties do not get released until that's done.
Okay. That's why I'm surprised that happened with the.
Oh, that was a project that occurred, God, 15 years ago, Gene.
Yeah,
and it was one of those projects that it just stretched out for so long. I think so many the boards changed over so many times that the developer was actually able to say, "Oh, I'll do it later. Oh, I'll do it later," and then there was confusion because my understanding is historically the developer wanted to do an off-site out of the development affordable housing unit, and then started working on a house, I forget where it was, somewhere downtown, and as it turned out, it was not equivalent to what would have been done, so that went by the wayside. And again, the two lots that were supposed to be the affordable housing unit lots, they just languished, but that won't happen again.
Yeah. Yes?
If I remember, possibly the last time, I mean, the state requires towns to have a certain percentage of affordable housing.
10%.
10% is what the requirement is for
right.
Georgetown. So
we're okay right now.
The state tried 11%.
Yep.
So we just have to keep it up every year, maintaining 10%, or does it go up each year on the requirement?
As the number of houses that are built in a town go up, the affordable housing count has to go up too.
So what's the projection for the next several years
for us to do our job right? And as they build houses, we actually build the affordable units with them. And actually on like 34 East Main, if that goes through, there'll be 8 units there, 2 of which will be affordable. And that's, that helps, yeah. We should be able to keep ahead of the game if we just keep our eyes open.
Did I see another hand over there, Ed?
Yeah, I'm just curious here. A simple question. 44 Searle Street seemed like a physically good-sized house. You see this as a single tenant or multiple tenants?
It's single tenant. It certainly has a size if you go inside. If you wanted to rebuild it, you could make a duplex out of it. But I think you'd have zoning issues and lots of other issues with it. It was just simpler to do a single with it.
And that is an affordable unit?
Yes, it will be.
Oh.
Yeah.
Are there any more questions? Paul, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Very well done, man. And now we move on to the out of the community housing category into the historical category, and those projects will start. The very first is the Peabody Library Portrait Restoration. And Mary, would you please introduce yourself, Mary Saunders?
Sure. I'm Mary Saunders. I happen to be a trustee for the Georgetown Peabody Library and a member of the Friends of the Library. And we're proposing that the oil portrait of George Peabody be refurbished and conserved. It has been having some difficulty. It's been in the library for over 100 years, and at this point, we need to do something for it so that it will be in the library for the next 500 years. Mm-hmm. Next slide.
Well, I don't think anybody at home can see the slides. Maybe we can tap on the glass. There we go.
Okay.
And we'll give folks at home a chance to, just a quick chance to read that. Here we go.
All right, so George Peabody did a lot for the town. He was a philanthropist who actually started the idea of giving lots of money from what you've earned over your lifetime. He had no children. He lived in London, but he had been born in poverty in what is now the town of Peabody. It wasn't at the time. And he's done a whole lot for the North Shore area. He also did a lot in the South in terms of establishing schools. The man valued education. He'd only had a couple years of education, and then he had to go to work. Georgetown was lucky in that his mother was born here and his sister lived here. So when his sister's congregation needed a church, he built it. But he realized that that was just for part of the town, and he wanted to do something for all of the town. So he built a library on Library Street, which is marshy, and the building was, you know, they had issues with water. So the present older portion of the Georgetown Peabody Library was built with the funds that he gave to the town, it replaced that original building. The portrait has been in that library ever since, and we've honored him for having done much for the town of Georgetown and other places, and the library is called the Georgetown Peabody Library after him. So the addition also had help from the funds that originally came from the Peabody Fund. So he's even in 2007 helping the town. Next slide. All right, so a quote from the Historical Society newsletter. The portrait once adorned the wall of the old library hangs prominently at the top of the stairs in the new addition, and if you look closely, you'll see an envelope in his hand with the words to the chairman of the Peabody Library, Georgetown, from George Peabody. That portrait looks like the next slide. You can see wrinkles up in the upper corner. The frame is in need of help. There's crackling all over it. The portrait was done by A. Bertram Shell in 1869. A. Bertram Shell is not a famous artist. He was better known for his photography. Next slide. So since we're concerned about the portrait, the Friends paid $300 for Oliver Brothers, who have both a Boston office and a Beverly office. They come highly recommended. There aren't all that many companies that do art restoration, but we're lucky, and this one is in Beverly, and they've been very kind to us. They've kept the portrait for us in storage, hoping that we can come up with the funds. And they did the evaluation, completed it in July of 2015. Next page, yes. This is the list of things, I'm not going to read it, that they found wrong with the portrait.
Question, if the canvas is really weak, what do you do about that?
Let's go to the next page. What they are going to do is put it on a vacuum hot table to relax it and reduce the cupping and flatten it, and then they're going to reback it with new linen with mylar in between, and they'll put it back on that vacuum hot table. They'll, once they've got it rebacked and the structure held together better, then they're going to work on the surface abrasion and repaint to fill in the parts that have been lost or places where the cracks have made it so that you can see the cracking and you need to in paint. They'll finally coat it, and they will clean the frame and redo some of the finish parts that have to be remolded and put on. And if we wanted to pay a whole lot of money, they'd regild it for us. We didn't opt for that. So the expected outcome from their proposal is that the treatment will produce a significant difference in the painting's appearance. The lining will strengthen the weakness of the canvas, unevenness of the surface will be corrected, cupped subsurface cracking will be significantly reduced, or possibly no longer visible, and the appearance will be greatly improved. This will cost up to $13,300. We certainly hope it'll be less than that.
Thank you very much, Mary. Any questions for Mary?
Well, just one more. Where did you have it on Library Street? Where was the library? Because I can't see anything.
Park and Ride.
Where the Park and Ride is?
Park and Ride is now. There was a church and a library behind it. And the library behind it actually had a hall where people would come and, you know.
We used it as a meeting room, didn't we?
Yeah.
We held meeting town meetings
room
there.
And, wow. And all sorts of important events went on in that old library.
Wow.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mary. Thank you very much. The next is the Historic Preservation category, South Byfield Cemetery flagpole. Gary, why don't you take it away and give us
there's
a
there's no one from the Historic Commission to speak on that, huh? Okay. Because this is actually a project by them. But just to let folks know, I'm on the board of directors of that cemetery, so
I'm somewhat involved in it, so I guess I'll speak on it. This is some of my notes from the Historic Commission's presentation to us, and it says the South Byfield Cemetery lies totally in the town of Georgetown on Warren Street. So just to let you know, even though it's called South Byfield, it is Georgetown. Let's see, and according to Elwell in his book on the story of Byfield, the South Byfield Cemetery was formed in 1859 and therefore accordingly considered by the Georgetown Historical Commission to be a historical town property. As such, the Georgetown Historical Commission is currently in the process of having it added to the Massachusetts Historical Commission's historic property database known as MACRIS, okay. So then basically there is no flagpole there, and each year typically at Memorial Day, the we have the commemorative march in town, but before that, earlier in the morning, our typically American Legion and VFW posts go to each cemetery and several other monuments in town, and they do a 21-gun salute in for the buried veterans. And so being no flag there, we've asked for this, and I guess there it is. You see, we hope to put a flag there and also a granite monument with some inscription, and that will be determined with consultation of the American Legion and the VFW post as to just what to put on the monument also. Well, I guess that's about it, unless there's any questions.
Thank you very much, Gary.
Thank you.
And we'll move on to our next one. Again, we're still in the historic preservation category, and this is the Brocklemank Museum Restoration. Chris Comiskey.
Hello.
Chris.
Hello. For those who don't, and Harry introduced me already, but I'm the president of the Georgetown Historical Society. You can go to our first slide, yeah?
Let me know where.
Okay. GHS is dedicated to preserving and promoting the history of Georgetown. We own and operate the Brocklemank Museum, which you see up on the screen, located at 108 East Main Street. It was built circa 1680. The old house has survived centuries of severe conditions, but like any old house, it needs constant upkeep. We are requesting funds for two projects this year, one for historic restoration and the other for preservation. Go to the next one. In July of 2015, we discovered that a ceiling had collapsed in the second floor curator's room. You can go to the next one too, another picture of that. Fortunately, this is not a room that the public is allowed in, but our volunteers do enter it from time to time. And as you can see, it's very hazardous to do so. And we're afraid that more of it will fall down. In addition, next slide, downstairs, directly below that room, we have a large sag in our kitchen ceiling. And this, unfortunately, is one of the rooms included in our tour, and we don't want that to come down like the other ceiling did. We want to get the, yeah, you can go to the next one too, there's another picture of it, and you can see kind of a crack going along there. So we want to get that fixed and shored up before anything comes down. So the estimated cost of the repairs of the two ceilings is $6,300. Next up, our second portion of our project is for preservation. Light is the enemy of delicate fabrics, documents, and photographs, and other artifacts. The old window shades currently in use at the museum do not offer adequate protection from light. You can see in that picture there, there's a lot of sunlight coming through. It just kind of is a screen, not much more. And next picture, many of them are ripped or have broken springs, or like that fine one there, it's ripped and has a broken spring, along with nothing, no thing to hold on to at the bottom. We would like to replace all of the old shades in the museum with new light blocking shades in all display rooms and curatorial storage rooms. The cost for this project is $700, bringing a total request for our CPA funding in 2016 to $7,000. Any questions?
Any questions, folks?
Okay.
Pretty straightforward.
Yep.
Fix the Brocklemank. Thank you, Chris. Still in the historic preservation category, First Congregational Church Doors, and presenting this will be Deb Lamoureux.
For those of you who don't know me, Deb Lamoureux. I'm the head of the trustees for the First Congregational Church here in Georgetown. The church was built in 1874 at the corner of Andover and Clark Street, our next door neighbor here. It was the third building of the first local congregational society organized as Raleigh's Second Parish in October of 1732. The church is architecturally and historically significant to Georgetown and is eligible for the National Register, as well as being a contributing component of the Village District and its associations with religious history of the town. In spite of the new exterior wall and roof materials, the building retains significant features of the Victorian Gothic Revival taste. As you can see in the picture in front of us, the particular elements of it are stick style. The church was an early commission for the Boston architectural firm of Peabody and Stearns, which increases its architectural significance. The church also houses an 1815 Revere bell and an 1874 Tracker pipe organ. The church is used as a town meeting place. It has been part of the fabric which makes Georgetown. The building has opened its doors to the community for special services, weddings, strawberry social, fall fairs, and many other community events. One of the most important amenities that the church offers is its food pantry, which provides food and personal items to many families in the Georgetown area and other surrounding communities. The church is also currently home to several nonprofit organizations, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, Council on Aging, TOPS, AA, Country Gardeners, Kinder Music, Senior Yoga, and many more. So, what we have asked, next slide please, is we want to preserve the historic integrity of this church facade, add handicapped accessibility and security to the building by, we have issues with our doors. Next slide. This is the front door of the church. It is a 9 foot tall door. Each door is 45 inches wide. They're huge. Next slide. The condition of the church, this is the inside of the doors. They look great from the inside and from the outside, but when you look at the next slide, you'll see everywhere that you see white, all the way up the length of the 9 feet high at the seams of all of the woodwork, that's light coming in from outside. The doors are 142 years old, and they are disintegrating in front of our faces. The second set of doors that we're dealing with, oh, I'm sorry, we'll go back to this. We are looking to, go back to the next slide, I'm sorry.
Go back to that,
that one. Nope, two back, forward.
Sorry, okay.
We have contacted three different companies to give us pricing to replace these doors and the two doors on the side of the church. Well, I'll show you in a minute. The pricing ranges went from $55,000 down to regular size doors that wouldn't be architecturally correct at $18,000. We've came to the realization that the church is so historically significant that we need to have the doors out front be exactly what they are. Burano is a company out of Florida that does this for all the time. This is what they do. They do church doors is an example of one that they had done a new restoration on. They are going to build the doors for us exact to the specifications to what you see right now. So when we replace the doors, you won't know that they've been replaced. We're excited about it. The second set of doors that we have are the two sets of doors that are on Clark Street. This is the first set. This set of doors is at street level for handicapped access. Next slide, hon. You can see the deterioration on the outside. This is the inside. As you can see again, the light, that goes all the way up and down to the bottom of the door. I don't have a picture of the threshold, but it's even bigger at the bottom of the threshold where you can see the doors are just rotting away. Next slide. The second set of doors is further down in the newer addition of the church. It also has the same problems where light is coming through, the doors are disintegrating and need to be replaced. You can do the next slide. There you go. That's one of the slides at the bottom edge of the door at the threshold level. So what we're looking for, I have to go, here we go, our request. We're requesting funding to replace these three main doors to the church. To the best of our knowledge, the main door and the first door on Clark Street are existing doors to the original structure. The third door is part of the addition and does not match. All three doors are in need of replacement. Our intention is to keep the front doors you see it now and replace the Clark Street doors with wider single doors with easier handicap access. We'd like to replace doors with units that are weather tight, energy efficient, and would provide a more secure environment for the church. Next slide. Installation timeline. Upon receipt of funds from the CPC and the town, CAD drawings will be drawn up for us and we will send them a deposit. As soon as we can get the drawings approved and to our specifications, they will then manufacture the doors and ship them from Florida, and it'll take about 10 weeks from completion. We will then have them, we're expecting that probably late in August, and installation of the doors will begin as soon as we have them. We expect it to be a two-week installation time frame, and should be completed by the first week in September. At this point, the funding that we are asking for is $26,500. The church has another donation of $5,000 towards the hardware for the handicap access and for all the security that has to go on these new doors, because the doors don't come with the hardware. That's a totally separate deal. So our consideration and what we are looking for is the $26,500 from the town. I'd like to thank the commission for considering us.
Are there any questions from the audience or the board? The board pretty much has all the questions that have been answered in other meetings. Anybody have any questions? Deb, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Still under the category of historic preservation, is the Pearly Senior Center Rehabilitation, a.k.a. the...
the soon-to-be Georgetown Senior Community Center.
There you go.
Oh, I'm Colleen Ranshaw Fiorello. I'm the Council on Aging Director here in town. And I'm really sorry. I may have the plague. But...
Just let me know, Colleen.
Certainly. So we've been at work on this project together for the last couple of years. We've been working together with the school committee, and once the school committee identified the opportunity to move ahead with the new Pembroke project, that became the vehicle for us to look at the Pearly. At the wing of the Pearly together. And so the Board of Selectmen and the Council on Aging and the School Company have been working on this since that time. So maybe we should just, I had included some of the demographics in the first slide. You know, just again explaining that currently, you know, we serve 1,428 elders in town, and in Massachusetts you're an elder over the age of 60. And that was a 54% increase since 2000 from the U.S. Census in 2000, so that was significant as we move to that forward at this point. And the UMass Donahue Institute of Economic and Public Policy Research shows that the elder population in Georgetown will increase to 2,158 in 2020 and to 2,922 to 2030. So that's as a result of the baby boomers, you know, becoming of age and turning 60, and that, you know, we're not necessarily that there are people that are 60 and moving into town at this point, although there are people that come to town that are elders, but the people who are living here and aging in place, as we've talked about, are representing that swollen population. So the increased level of service and, you know, was what allowed us to be able to say, to look at this opportunity. We've looked at other opportunities and we've been building our programming. And it was evident, you know, then looking at the Pearly, that it met the criteria. It's located in the village center. It's an existing structure with that's handicap accessible and has parking. So, you know, working with the school department, we've looked at the plan to be able to repurpose five of the existing classrooms that had housed the kindergarten and first graders in the past, as well as to share the cafeteria and kitchen area with the preschool program, which will remain in place, and you know, to work with the school department to perhaps share the gym upon occasion or other areas in the building. But the five rooms will become the senior community center. Sure. I know, I can't even see. So we currently offer 30 overlapping cultural, social, health, and informational programs to local elders and their families in our three different locations. We do work here at our offices at Town Hall here. All the information and referral application assistance, that's applications for even the rental assistance program, will assist with mass health applications, food stamp applications, which is now known as SNAP. We have more than one community action heating assistance program. All of those pieces. Insurance counseling, that is our SHINE program, which has, again, as people are turning 60 and then 65 and needing to look at supplemental insurance, that program has grown tremendously. Any of our outreach and transportation coordination, income tax preparation, which just wrapped up, and that has doubled in the last couple of years. Our newsletter production, all of that takes place here at Town Hall. We use the conference room. Sometimes we've come up here to use a program, and sometimes we've used the downstairs conference room as well. The First Congregational Church has been a tremendous partner. They provide, we do pay rent, but they provide the congregate meal site, which allows us then to have social and recreational programs before lunch. And that's often the way to get people to come into relationship. We can say, you know, come before you have lunch, come for this program, and it gives us an opportunity to meet people. Our exercise classes, our yoga classes held at the church, the strength training classes still held at Trestle Way, and again, the Housing Authority has been very kind to us and allowed us to use their community room for exercise programs for triad, for men's breakfast. Also at the church, we have our health screening programs and health education or community education programs. So, and Pembroke, the new school still hosts our intergenerational reading program and the indoor walking program, which they had hosted in their previous school, and we're very glad to have them still house that. So the next slide. The new space will repurpose five of the classrooms and we'll share use of the kitchen and the cafeteria, so we'll be able to continue our meals program. Also share use of the gymnasium. Although I think, you know, our plan will be to most of our exercise-based programs in one of the classrooms. One classroom, which is located off of North Street, will be our new entranceway. And so it had included an existing overhang. It had been an entranceway in the past. And so we will create a new entranceway there. It will be open into a reception area and a welcoming area and the administrative offices for the COA director, the administrative assistant, and the outreach worker. That will also then have another door, a new door, into the hallway. We're also going to move a set of doors up the hallway so that we'll be able to secure that space and be separate from the school. And across the hallway will be the kitchen and the cafeteria and the classroom. Next to that, the cafeteria is going to be repurposed to hold the three confidential meeting areas. So we'll be able to move the SHINE, the health insurance counseling program there, or the income tax preparation program, the public health nurse who meets and does our blood pressure clinics. And that way, people will be able to wait for those programs with and have some privacy, as opposed to that you're waiting all in one room, and so if somebody who's there for yoga doesn't necessarily need to know who's there for blood pressure. Also, our elder law consult. We have an elder law attorney in the area that's been very good in offering us some free consultation once a month. So we'll be able to house those things in that classroom. The classroom next to that, we plan to, you know, not to, we, those are the only two classrooms that we actually plan to alter, but we plan to use the classroom next to the confidential meeting areas for small group activities, and, you know, keep our doll making program there, our bingo and the card games, and create a reading area. The other two classrooms we'll use for large group activities. One I plan to, you know, use more for the health education and community education, and the third one will hopefully include some new exercise equipment as well, be a space for strength training and yoga. So the next slide, which is too small for me to read. So voters at last year's town meeting approved $45,000 for the Senior Center Design and Engineering Services. And the design and engineering bid was awarded to Sterling Associates of Cambridge in July 2015. And Bill Sterling is the principal of that firm, and he began working with us at that time and came up with some very creative ideas to go along with the conceptual plan that we had in mind. Voters at the November 2015 special town meeting approved $175,000 as the first phase of construction. During that and following that time, the Board of Selectmen and the School Committee were at work on the shared use agreement for the Senior Center, and they completed work on that agreement in December. So the Board of Selectmen and the Council on Aging presented $175,000 proposal to fund the second phase of construction in January to match the town meeting funds. Ambient Temperature Corporation in Newburyport was then selected as the project's general contractor in February, and Ambient Temperature Corporation worked on the middle high school project as well as the Pembroke, New Pembroke School, so they're familiar with the town. Carpentry students from Whittier Votech began demolition and framing work in March. And so we actually now can see, you know, walls up, and it's become exciting to be able to say, okay, this is exactly what we've planned. So at the town meeting on May 2nd, voters will be asked to consider $125,000 as from the CPC recommendation. And at the same time, they will be at the special town meeting, which will be held before the annual. They'll be asked to support $50,000 from the stabilization account, and then at the annual we'll be asked to support the $125,000, and that will provide the $175,000 which is needed to complete the project. So hopefully, you know, with all the pieces coming together for the funding, more construction will continue to take place, and we hope that the final completion date should be no later than November. I mean, it could be October. And, but you know, at this point, it's coming, and we can just keep doing that, keep doing what we're doing until we're in. So that's what we're hoping, that by, you know, by moving the programs and the services into one place, we'll be able to become more efficient and more effective. It will also create an opportunity for a greater flow of people. So I know that, you know, as people will arrive for one thing, they will be able to become in greater relationship with us and participate in other areas. I'm hoping that we'll be able to do some additional exercise opportunities. I would like to be able to have, you know, a treadmill in place and an exercise bike, but it would be nice to be able to do a Tai Chi class. We've wanted to do that for a long time. But some of the other pieces, such as space to be able to have bereavement and caregiver support, you know, just ongoing smaller activities like that, even to something, you know, a book club, to be able to have space that you could host some of those smaller activities. We do want to be able to have a food pantry in place, and we've really appreciated the food pantry being in place at the Congregational Church, and that's been enormously helpful to many elders. So I'm hoping that, you know, with everything that we're doing, that we should be good for the next, you know, 10 to 20 years, 25 years, 30 years, I'm hopeful. I did take a picture of the kids working as they began demolition of the ceiling, and that's in the classroom that will hold, house the confidential meeting areas. And the next slide. And that classroom now has framing up even. So the next slide is a schematic of the floor plan. And the following slide is a rendering of the new entranceway off of North Street.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Colleen. Are there any questions?
Just a quick one. What's the average size of a room there?
Well, they're approximately 800 to 900 square feet.
So 30 by 30?
Yeah.
Interesting. It's pretty good size then.
Yes. Yeah. And we will fill them very quickly.
So. I have a quick question.
Sure.
You'll be moving out of town hall?
Yes.
Who's going to get the offices?
I know. That's really, you know, I mean, it's been very nice to be here and to be part of, you know, just it gives us a good sense of how the pieces of town government come together. But it's logistically, it's difficult to manage your programs when I'm still the only full-time person. So, you know, I'm moving from spot to spot. I think, you know, we do have to be able to be in place at the school. We're going to miss our spot here. But we'll be back and forth.
Thank you, Colleen. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And that concludes our historic category projects. We move on to the last and final category, the open space category projects, starting with the open space preservation, invasive prevention and control. Rachel Bancroft from the Conservation Commissioner.
Okay, can everybody hear me? I usually speak really quietly. Okay. I'm not going to read what's up there. You guys can read that. I'll do a summary. We're just seeking the approval of the Community Preservation Committee to combine the three existing CPA accounts to allow the monies in the accounts to be used to combat the invasive species, not only in Pentucket Pond, but also in Rock Pond as well. So it's using funds that are already in place, so we're not asking for any additional funds. It's just taking the three that are there and renaming them, so they can be used for the milfoil that is happening in Rock Pond right now. Go ahead. Yep. Both ponds are actually connected, and so it will also be worded so that we can use the funds for the Parker River that connects the two ponds together, so that the milfoil, they won't keep going back and forth. Go ahead. These are the three different funds that are already there, and we're just asking that they be combined and renamed and put together so that we have 65, I cannot quite read that.
548.
Thank you. In total, so that will be available to the Rock Pond Association to fight the milfoil that's happening right now.
Thank you, Rachel. Thank you very much. Any questions? This is not a technical appropriation. This is not coming out of the fund. This was previously appropriated funds that are sitting, waiting to be spent. But what happened was we worded the warrant article so darn tightly that it could only be used for the Kabamba, and it could only be used in Pentucket. So
right. Yeah.
Now what we have to do is try to repurpose it. And naturally, the best way to do it is to...
And it was for an invasive species in Pentucket Pond. So
absolutely,
it's being used for the same thing, just opening it up so that it can be used for Rock Pond. And I know that the president of the Rock Pond Association is here too.
Absolutely.
So he can answer
Mr.
any questions.
Mr. McGrain, if there's any questions or?
No, I'd just like to thank everybody. And for anybody that's not aware of what we're doing, we formed this association 8 months ago to we came across that this milfoil infestation, and through our membership and some donations, we are actually doing the first year's treatment out of our own money. It all came out of our pockets. So this is for further treatment.
I see a hand, Mayor.
So this $65,000 is going to be used over a number of years because a single treatment isn't going to
right.
completely become where our kind of model is off.
No, it won't. It won't. It's an ongoing. It's a fight. It's an ongoing battle with the invasive species.
We're just hoping we can get it to the point where it can be managed, hopefully just by the association and with very little funds going forward. But the first, I don't want to put a year on it because it all depends what this stuff does, how quick it grows, how much we can keep people out of it as it's growing because it goes through growing cycles. We've posted large signs down on the boat ramp. The end of last year, we put buoys out trying to keep people out of it. We're looking to do more, maybe get some education through the state so we can actually set up and offer people information down at the boat ramp, possibly do inspections of boats. It's going to be a very big project, and if it's in Rock Pond, it may not be in Pentucket yet, but the flow goes that way, and if we can keep it out of Pentucket, it would be a huge thing to do.
It's a fragmentary, just one tiny, tiny piece will start an entire infestation.
It'll create a map. It'll turn a body of water into a swamp in about 5 or 6 years.
Bear in mind the way that the CPC wrote the Warren article, it also will allow for any future invasive species, the Kabamba, as well as the milfoil, or something that we never heard of before, to be used for it. So it'll allow the flexibility, the CONCOM to have the flexibility to battle it any way they can.
It's an ongoing thing, and it's not just, we're not unique. It's an ongoing thing if you look around the state. Has problems in hundreds of bodies of water.
Yeah. Thank you. Any more questions for that?
Just quick, I remember when we were actually talking about it, there was going to be a thought about at least putting together a 5-year plan so it'd be some kind of a structured approach to getting rid of the milfoil and the whatever might pop up in Pantucket.
They do. They're starting. The first treatment is scheduled for the end of May, beginning of June.
We don't have an exact date yet. We're waiting for the notice of intent to all get straightened out, but it will be the end of May. I talked to the people that we contracted to do this treatment. It will be the end of May, beginning of June. You have to treat it when it's in its growing stage. I think it's growing. It's actually in its growing stage now. It seems like it's coming out quicker than they expected.
Is the herbicide Sonic, is that the only one still available?
We're not using Sonic. We're using Diquat, which is a different, it's actually a less harmful.
Right.
It does, we have as everybody knows, you have to submit to Natural Heritage
right.
for any species that this could affect, and they gave their approval for everything we were going to do. And what happens with milfoil, it's nearly impossible to completely eradicate.
Right.
Our goal is to just get it so we can control it within a few years. Then there are a few other methods. If you can get it localized and just in spots, that you can do things just in spots to keep it down, and hopefully in the long term maybe get it so it may not show up, but it'll be years and years in the making to get to that point.
Well, I know when before Sonic was the only one available and it was fairly expensive, so I'm glad that there's other choices.
Well, it depends on the invasive.
Right.
That's how they come up with the
treatment. Probably the 5-year plan, maybe they're still trying to develop things that are cheaper to
Yeah, well, I would see a 5-year plan as after you accomplished it to level X, then you
right.
go into the next phase. It's not a time-driven, but an event-driven. But you need some kind of a plan, otherwise
exactly.
you go in there
well,
and you
Well, we're
whack
hoping
it.
Going, this is the association's intention, and it has to go through the Conservation Commission. is if we can get it a little more controllable, there are other ways that you can combat small sections of
right.
it. They're what they call Bendit mats that you can use for a small area, and it drops down and it allows any organisms that exist under that mat to go to get out of there, that they're not trapped, but it will kill the weeds, but it also will kill any, it's not very specific as to what, it'll kill any mm-hmm. weed growth, so it has to be done in small areas. And that's something that the association's kind of looked at. There's a lot of different angles. People talked about a lot of different ways. There was talk about buying a harvester, which is about anywhere from $100,000 to $150,000 thing that would cut the weed. But when, as Rachel said, the weed, this weed milfoil, it's a tube, and it fractures. It fractures on its own by the end of the summer, and that's how it spreads, not from seed. So a boat running through it, a fishing line going through it, somebody paddling through it, a duck, anything can break it off, and one little piece will create hundreds of plants. It just turns everything, you'll have major, if it goes untreated, you'll have major fish kills. And the native species of plants will die off because this just is so fast growing that it won't have a chance for anything to grow. Mm.
Is it in the Park or River too?
I'm sorry, what was the question?
That we know of.
I wanted to know if it was in the Park or River too.
Oh.
No. Yeah. But, well, actually the pond's a part of the Park or River tributary, so it's...
Yeah.
Well, thank you. If there are no more questions about the reallocation of the funding, we'll move on to the next. Still in the open space and recreation category, East Main Street Recreational Facility. Jim?
Sure. So part of this water quality we talk about is the last 10 years we've gotten the Pawtucket Pond beach area to really... The bacteria counts have dropped drastically. A lot of that was through septic system Title V around the ponds and some water treatment area. I'm on the wrong subject. I'm on the American Legion. We'll go to that next. East Main Street Recreational Park, we have done phase one of the work. You might as well scroll through the pictures. 2006, we went to the town to build a new park. We started the work on East Main Street, 24 meetings with the Planning Board and 7 meetings with the Conservation Commission, which now 2016, we've completed phase one. Go ahead through the pictures. This is the road going up through the New Life Community Church, which is across the street from the cemetery on East Main Street next to United Foam. We have a retaining wall. This is the road going down to the new park. We have a railing on the right side. Protect us from the wetlands. Next picture. This kind of shows you the top, the same picture from the top of the hill down into the long road into the park area. This is the way the park is laid out now. This is the final drawing. The area here is all done. The driveway goes all the way down. At the end there, there'll be a dog park. The parking lot has not been done, or the pad for the skateboard park. So we've done the road all the way down, we've done the field, and we're now going to the next phase, which is the dog park, the parking lot, and the skate park. Your next picture. These are the $80,000 worth of skate park equipment we got from the town of Everett about 80 years ago. We had someone look at them from Oklahoma who does all skate parks in New England. He says most of it is salvageable, so we'll basically... purchase a couple of pieces of equipment from them, and we use these additional pieces of skate equipment that they will incorporate into a design for the skate park. Next picture. Oh yeah, these are just different pieces of the concrete skate park equipment that we have in storage there. One more. Yeah. We have a electricity that's got to go down as well. We've got a sprinkler system for the field that you'll see in the next picture, but we haven't ran electricity down to that site. And that's the field. The gate's open, so you're welcome to go down and if you want to. There's a field there. That's all been cleared. It's been seeded. It'll probably start being used in the fall, possibly for the young kids. And we're just asking for the money to finish it up, basically finish the park off and move on. That's another angle. This is where the dog park will be right here. This is the end of the park, and right in here will be a dog park. It's possible they'll be done before the summer. We're working on that right now. So we have about $50,000 left from the money that was originally given to us, and we're trying to finish that, the dog park. So people can start using it right now. You know, if we get it in, people can get down there and start using it this summer. Next picture. So these are our expenditures left. And that's the list. I can't go anymore. We have parking lot construction, skate park construction, environmental restoration tasks. We have to put in some rain gardens. We have to fix a wetlands area, restore wetlands area. And I asked for as much money that was on the list, and it came out to be $200,000. And hopefully this will be done before I retire.
Jimmy, where do you, I'm using a diagram, where's the wetlands replication going to take place at?
There's actually a spot on the drawing. I don't have the drawings with me, but there's okay. Actually a pot on the original plan. So there's a small
down
in here. If you look at the plan, we had to take out a small right in here.
Under
5,000 square feet, you can replicate it.
Yeah.
And they put a design, they put it over there, and it was approved by the Conservation Commission.
Okay.
So we're trying to finish this up. This is the one half of the greenway, the land last year, which was the Alston parcel and the Tolman parcel. And of course, you heard a parcel left. That whole area is now continuing the greenway all the way down to Martell Way. There's really only one other vital lot. There's actually two there, but one vital lot that would now establish a greenway from here, which is one end of the park, to Martell Way, which is the other end. And you could theoretically walk from here all the way out to Whaler Brook Farm, which would, you know, be all protected. So it establishes a nice protected area. It's the Sac Center of Georgetown. These new developments that just came in, if they had had this land, if we hadn't purchased this land 5 or 6 years ago, there would be more than 22 homes out there right now. All this land now abuts that parcel. That was the Ingraham parcel that we were worried about, and they were waiting for him to get in there, and as soon as we got it, he got in there. So you got 22 homes as a result. So I'm very happy that we got that land when we did, because for us people in town, that land will be open space and enjoyed, and it really works out well. It's when I go up to Cherry Hill and Damaris, and you look at all the neighborhoods over the years that have just continually engulfed that whole area. That won't be Georgetown in that section, which will be nice.
One more parcel.
But we'll wait a couple of years before we.
It'll be a while. Question, Gene?
I have a question. Excuse me. You're requesting from this town meeting $200,000.
Right.
What is the total that's been appropriated and approved to date?
The total have been approved to date. We have.
It's got to be close to a million, no?
Yeah, nope.
It's got to be a million plus.
According to Mary, $602,279. Appropriation 079 of 350, appropriation of 090 of 200,000, and appropriation of 114 of 140,000. So I'm sorry, it's 690,000.
And that's,
we spent 602.
And that's according to the town accountant?
That's according to
Mary McEnemy, town accountant.
And about of that 690, it took 110, approximately 110 to permit.
And so this is 200 additional. So you're up to $890. Yeah, it's close to $1 million.
About $1 million. That's what the cost.
Actually, that was the cost of both practical infrastructure and Gale Associates said it would cost, and we told them they were nuts. And we thought it'd be much less, but it's exactly what they said it would cost.
So
the engineers are usually pretty good at estimating the cost.
Yeah. I went out and looked at the site last night. There seemed to be a lot of stumps or twigs growing up.
There's roots. There's some roots that we've actually retained. We've kept money away from Manta's got a hit list. We've kept $33,000 in escrow until he resolves those issues. So we have some things that the engineer has decided has not been done, and we've retained that money until it gets done.
Can you go back to your drawing again?
Sure.
So right now, where the parking lot is in the proposed skate park, that's
yes.
Not cleared yet?
This area is not cleared, and this has all been done through here. This has been done, this park, the dog park has been in, but this field has been cleared and grassed.
I should be able to read this plan, but I'm not getting it. Where is the pond on the edge of the field?
The pond is over here. It's not on the plan because there's a pond there, but it's shown on the master drawing, but not.
So that driveway or road that you're showing is coming from East Main Street.
This is coming from East Main Street. There's a swamp over here, and there's a pond over here.
Yeah. All right. So to the left of that driveway is where there'll be a lot more clearing.
Yes.
Is the extent of going deeper into the woods done at this point?
No. This area here is wooded. There will be more trees taken down for that.
But then that is the extent?
That's the extent.
I have to tell you, from where I live on Searle Street, when I came back from vacation last June, I could hear chainsaws and trees crashing for days and days and days. And it wasn't turning leaf, it was this project. I mean, the amount of tree clearing was truly disheartening and almost sickening to me.
I agree. I mean, we had to clear some land. The conservation asked us to divide the parcel into two parcels. This was the parcel I wanted them to conserve, and they swapped the parcels on me. So this is the land we cleared. I would have preferred to have taken the land that they protected, but that didn't happen. So
it was swamp land.
It was, well, some of it was. There was issues. It was in the, I think it was the 100-foot floodplain, which was the issue. But you know, there's 40 acres out there we protected. We bought two ponds. We had to use some piece of land for a park, and this 4 acres got it. I mean, it's.
So when this is all built and done, who maintains this facility after this?
The park and rec until a DPW is established in the future. But the park and rec.
Does that require additional CPA funds, or does that then become town budget funds?
The town budget, like any other park, it'll be run by the town and under a town budget. I have a $40,000 budget right now that's maintained for American Legion, West Street, Little's Hill, and all the other parks in town. And this will be put on the escrow of those parks, and we'll budget work that has to be done to that park in the same way.
Okay, because of the proximity to the ponds, are you allowed to use fertilizer?
It's not in the wetland. There is some restrictions, but I should be able to use fertilizer in a main portion of that field.
Do you have any buffer to keep the runoff from going into the ponds? Or will that be running into the ponds when you fertilize and it all just runs off of the grass?
Well, a lot of the grade is away from the pond. There is some grading that's taken into effect that. There's a stone wall going along that pond. But I'm in, like West Street, I'm limited in fertilizer because of the well fields. Those restrictions aren't yet put on me on this field.
Okay.
Any other questions? Moving along, and from this park, we go to another park, and this is the...
Can I ask before you continue, Harry? Can you put all of this up on the website? Go back and review all these...
We usually do, Gene. We usually do. And usually what happens is the cable company is usually pretty good about putting the whole thing not only on TV many, many times on the cable, but as you know, you can go on the town website and you can click on the link for GoTV and you can stream it to your mobile device or your home.
I can, but I just can't read those things like Jim just showed, the engineering...
Yeah, well, we usually put it on the website eventually.
Can you do it before town meeting?
I can try.
Thank you.
Next, the open space for park and recreation, rehabilitation of American Legion Park. Suzanne?
Good evening. Hi. My name is Suzanne Caulfield, and I'm here on behalf of the Park and Rec. And we are requesting $25,000 to safely separate the fishing and swimming platform that's desperately needed to be separated. And you'll see everything listed in regards to what we need to be able to make a safe division of swimming and recreational fishing area. And you'll see that the request was $17,000 for that. And that was part one, and then part two, we are requesting masonry work around the 6 pavilion steel posts. We're looking to put the masonry work around the posts to prevent graffiti and to be able to complete the facelift of the park and the pavilion itself, and that request is $8,000. And the next slide, you'll see the overview of everything we've done at the park. And that's it.
Thank you, Suzanne.
You're welcome.
Any questions about American Legion Park?
So we have $250,000 in it.
Parkland is expensive.
Have you seen how gorgeous this is?
Oh, yeah, it's nice. I like
and I've been there every day since, and you can literally count more than 100 people every day there. Yeah. So we definitely do need everything that we're requesting. It's going to be a great thing to be able to separate that swim platform and then separate that fishing dock and make everyone just enjoy it even more. Thank you.
Absolutely. Parkland's expensive, historic restorations and preservation's expensive, basically.
Everything's expensive.
Right. Yeah.
I just like to say, as part of the milfoil and the keeping the invasive weeds, I mean, we're hundreds of people using the beach because the water quality's improved so much. The pond's coming back as a recreational area that everybody's going to now. Yeah. I mean, there was a time, you know, in the 80s and 90s that the deterioration of the water quality was really affecting recreational users. Well, go down in the park on a hot day in the summer now, and there's hundreds of people swimming. The improvements they made to the fence on the other side of the pond, I was walking down Pond Street and people were fishing. So people are starting to use the pond as the way it was intended. It's really good to see that people are fishing in different spots now and swimming, and it's really nice. So we can continue to make these improvements to the invasive weeds and stuff. It's a good asset for the town. People, they're getting to use the ponds, and I think it really helps.
The next project is open space preservation category, Camp Denison road paving.
Hello.
Good.
Yes. Hi, I'm Jim Lacey. I'm on the Camp Denison committee, and Drew Curry is a member of the Conservation Commission. What we're looking for is to pave the original, could you pop this through be quick, the next one, please. All right, we're looking to pave the initial 850 feet of the camp because we're having a lot of problems with potholes and things like that. We'll get into that. For people that don't know what Camp Denison is, if you could, again, it's town-owned conservation land on Nelson Street. It's 44 acres. It comes under the purview of the Conservation Commission. And people in town use it all the time. They get on there and walk dogs. They just walk on the trails. People use, there are buildings. People use it for birthday parties and fundraisers for high school sports teams, and so it's a facility that's being used more and more all the time. So just a little, very good, sorry, that was quick. In 1931, a group of people called Denison House that were, as it says, a private social services group, rented the land, and by 1935, they had purchased it and had started to put buildings on there. And it was used for to bring underprivileged children out from the city, you know, to show them what it was like in the country. And that pretty much was what it was for through various groups. It was turned over to a group that was the Dorchester House or something like that. I actually forget the name. Up until the 1980s. And then they didn't have the money, so in to keep it up. So in 1997, the town bought it jointly with the state. It's under the Conservation Commission, and it's maintained and operated by the Camp Denison Committee. And what we're looking for the money is, we maintain the property by renting the buildings. And in the spring, as you can see from these next two slides, the potholes are terrific. There are times when people couldn't get in here, and it requires constant maintenance, and Peter Durkee and the Highway Department does that for us. And in fact, he's been down twice to scrape that driveway and to put material on it to smooth out the potholes.
And these photos were taken only a few days after he had gone in and kind of...
That's right. And we had to do it again. He just did it again last Wednesday.
Yeah.
And this is the, this is kind of the overview of what we're going to do.
Sure. Excuse me. Very sorry. Very sorry.
Well, he was saying, there's just a couple of pictures that show the kind of extent of the problem. What we would like to do is go in and resurface the first 850 feet off the entry road into the camp. The project proposes to resurface the first 230 feet of the road, which is presently paved, and then on the next 620 feet, we are actually going to go in, grind up the existing surface material there, mix it with another 6 inches of a gravel base material, actually T-base asphalt gravel. And then pave over the first entire 850 feet, so the initial entry into the camp will be paved, and this is the area where the worst conditions are. The initial portion of the roadway, the land is very flat and it drains poorly, so the asphalt T-base that's in there right now just won't hold up, as you can see by the photos. I think you can move on to the next one now. You can see here, this is just a map that's part of the assessor's map from the town. You can see Camp Denison's the area in green with the old rail line up at the top of the picture there, and a part of the camp is also abuts the Baldpate Pond State Park. So essentially all those green areas are really entirely wooded. And you can see on the left is Nelson Street, which is the access point to the camp. The yellow area is the area of the roadway that we would like to basically upgrade. It's just a narrow entry way into the camp. And you can see Baldpate Pond is immediately on the right-hand side south of the camp. And so this just gives you an idea where it is. And that's the edge of the green line on the green area on the right. The boundary is also the Georgetown-Boxford town boundary, too. So Baldpate Pond is actually in Boxford. So if you move on to the next one, thanks. This is just a couple of, I'm an engineer, so I get too detailed, I guess, sometimes, but this is basically detail A is what we're going to be doing to the first 230 30 feet of the roadway is basically filling in all the potholes, repaving and patching, and then patching and then paving over the entire presently paved area, and then treating the shoulders. On the right, detail B is where we'll be going in, putting in 6 more inches at a minimum of additional gravel base, and then paving it over with another 4 inches of actual bituminous or asphalt paving, and then dressing up the shoulders. We'll have a 3-foot shoulder on either side, so that in actuality, most of the roadway, it'll be about 19 feet wide, so you'll have enough width to pass as you drive in, but the paved area will only be about 13 feet wide. And that's basically what we're trying to do. If you have the next slide. This is just we put a project schedule together just so we could plan for it. We have been working with Peter Durkee in the highway department. He is working with us to do the entire project. It'll be work done partly by the highway department and partly by contractors under the highway department, as the equipment needs and the materials needs supply. We put an estimate together, which I can show in the next slide. Harry, thank you. We just broke it down this way right now. Site preparation and drainage improvements. A big part of this is to actually put a new culvert in where there's just totally inadequate drainage, and then clean up all the side shoulders so that there's good quality drainage, positive drainage on either side of the roadway. This will also help stabilize the whole thing. And then preparing and upgrading the roadway base is basically bringing in all the additional gravel materials that we need to stabilize it. New pavement installation, and then site stabilization, low erosion control and cleanup at the end of the job. And there will be a few permits required because we do have to make a notice of intent submittal to the Conservation Commission, and which is going in a few days. The previous schedule that I showed alludes to that. We'll basically be working with the highway department all along to get pricing, which, as I said, we have preliminary pricing here, but we will get solid fixed pricing on each item as we go along, and to actually do the work during the summer. It takes some coordination with the various tenants that we have. We have a group in there for a whole month, so we're going to have to work around them. So we just have to play it by ear as we gain tenants to the camp as we go along.
Yeah, actually it works out pretty well because there's a day camp in there in the month of July. So we would probably do the site preparation work on weekends because there'll be nobody there. And the highway department would come in and do that, and then the paving would be done in August when most people use it on weekends, so they could do it during the day. So that's kind of the coordination that we have to do. I think that's it.
It was that the last slide. My apologies. I didn't realize it was the last slide.
That's all right.
My apologies. Are there any questions or?
How far in is the road to, let's say, where you park in the field when sometimes you're having some events? I mean, how far in comparison to that does this go?
I would guess it's at least double.
This goes up to the first trail.
Right.
Okay.
There's a one car parking spot.
Halfway as
in, yeah, I would say it's about halfway.
My guess is the road entirely would. To get to the lodge is about 2,000 feet, and we're doing 850.
Okay, and you're saying, do you see a phase two, or you're saying the rest of the road actually is maintainable?
It's more stable. We're thinking about possibly paving at the bridge that was installed a couple of years ago. That area there.
That would just help maintain that.
Right, yeah. That area specifically is a little bit problematic, and we're keeping that in mind as we do this and looking at the money. We may have enough to just to do that part of it also, you know, if it works out that way. So okay. We'll do it now. So
thank you.
And there's no wetlands in that area. The wetlands that we're dealing with are really up in the entry section that we're going to upgrade, and that's why we're going through a notice of intent on it, even though it's the CONCOM that's having the work done. So especially because the CONCOM's
got to do it right.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Any other questions, folks? Drew, thank you. Jim, thank you.
Okay.
And I believe this is the last of the open space preservation projects. This is the OSRP, the Open Space and Recreation Plan Goals, and Peter Burns from the chair of the Open Space Committee.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. I just want to tell you about a presentation that we're going to have now on the Open Space Trail Linkage Analysis and Feasibility Study. This past year, or the last couple of years actually, the Open Space Committee has been working with a consultant and the Park and Rec Committee and also the Conservation Commission to develop our open space plan, to update that plan. And so we've gone through, and the open space plan is essentially a strategic plan for how we want to manage our open space and our recreational lands. And so we have goals and objectives in there that that we want to address to keep on track with how we want to manage these lands. So we've got that open space plan completed, and there's a draft before the state right now, and they're reviewing it, and hopefully that'll be approved soon. So what we want to do now is look at a couple different goals and objectives within that plan that we think will help us move forward with managing our open space lands. And those are linking the open space parcels and trails and improving access to the conservation lands. So what we'd like to do is go through, and we've got, as Jim Demento mentioned, we have our Greenway, which is a series of conservation parcels that we've connected and purchased, and that goes from East Main Street to all the way to Martell Way. So we'd like to be able to have a plan where we could develop trail maps and a linkage system to link all those lands in there, because there's no trails or anything in there. We also want to be able to improve access to the current conservation lands that we have that are throughout the town. And we also have a bike trail that's going to be going through the rail trail. We've got funding for that, and that in the next couple of years is going to come into play. So we'd like to be able to link our open space lands that connect with that trail and be able to make the trails more accessible and improve access and improve the utility of the trails. So what we'd like to do is hire a consultant to do that, to work with us in the town, work with the Park and Rec, work with the Conservation Commission, and with the Open Space Committee, and do a linkage analysis to give us some ideas about how to prioritize some of these projects and generate some maps on how we could put some trails in and prioritize some of these projects moving forward. So next slide, please. Sorry. That's it. So we're asking for $30,000. We've got some estimates of what that would take. So that would be working with us to, you know, walk through the lands, look at all of our existing maps and our inventory of our open space and recreational parcels, developing some plans and a feasibility study about how to go forward with improving access and creating trails.
Thank you, Pete.
Sure.
Any questions? Okay, and
if you'll, most of the towns around us, Boxford has a trail association. They're much farther ahead than Georgetown. They're looking at, when the developments come in, they look at, well, they know that already when the developer takes a parcel, well, we need to get a right of way from this parcel to that trail, or this parcel to that railroad bed. And Georgetown is not doing any of it, and it's really time we catch up with our neighbors, because they're protecting horses can get from a horse farm and go to the recreational area, because 10 years ago they thought it through and they put an easement there. And you know, the top of Andover Hill is a horse farm, but they can't get to any of the conservation areas or ride or any area because there's no easements. And if we start thinking about it, you know, potentially we could free up a lot of places where people can ride horses and mountain bike and walk to the rails trail right out of their house, instead of having a walk 3 miles down and go through someone's backyard. And it's just, you know, a little bit of forethought doing it now before we really build out the town and we don't have those choices left to us. That's all.
I think what you're trying to say is you shouldn't have to get in your car to take a walk.
Yeah, I mean, some of it's already been done. If you look at Central Street, there's a park that the Park and Rec owns that we haven't done anything with. But that's when the rail trail goes through, you'll be able to park there and walk over to the rails trail. So some of it's already been done, but it's been done kind of by accident. It's that, you know, well, not accident, but someone had the forethought to think about it. So we're asked trying to, like you said, when you talk about a five-year plan, we're trying to put a plan together. Yeah. You say, this is a vital piece. When that piece comes up, we've got to get an easement through it. And this is the reason.
Gary?
Well, Jim has brought forth a question in some of what he said about like Bloxford having a group, perhaps that does this.
BGA Bold.
Will this help you to set up perhaps like a group of volunteers? Will they help you to set up? Because I think most of these things are volunteer driven, like many things in towns.
I think they are. I just think we're not there yet. I mean, yeah. You could, on any Saturday, you could have a pickup truck full of people with rakes show up at Lufkin's Brook and go ahead and clear it out and fix the trails. But I think what we need is a plan to move forward. And that's the hope here, is to look at what our opportunities are in the long term and hopefully get some prioritization of some of these things, so we have some kind of low-hanging fruit that we could handle right away and things that we want to do down the road. So I think that, developing some kind of a association or something like that, sure, that might be a recommendation that comes through, or that might be something that we just decide to do on our own as we see, hopefully we get this feasibility study and it's really going to clear things up about how we want to move forward with this, give us some goals and objectives here on it.
Do we know where all the trailheads are?
We do. We've got a pretty good we've got a great open space map, and we've worked a lot with the Merrimack Valley Planning Commission to develop open space maps. So we do, we know where all our parcels are, but not all of them are as easy to access as some of the, like Lufkin's Brook. I think people know how to get in there, but even that, that's a real long-standing. It used to be a really well-used parcel right by the VFW and behind there, out to West Street. But it gets overgrown or it gets neglected, and so.
Is there some place somebody could find out? Like the Littles Hill has got a built-in trailhead, right, as does Bella Woods.
Yeah.
And the last one is close to my house. But if you start looking into it, it looks like you're going into solid brush. There's a sign, and then there's nothing.
And I think that's really what a lot of this is about. One of these goals and objectives in the open space plan that we want to address through this feasibility study is to improve access to some of these places. And I think the Conservation Commission has been very insightful on this as we gain parcels of property to make sure that there's some kind of trailhead or some kind of access point. But it doesn't stop there. You've really got to take the next step to really make it accessible maybe to people with disabilities, or more cars, better parking, safe parking off the street, that kind of thing. That was there was a really good example of that off of West Street when we bought the Hampshire Woods parcel. Mm-hmm. We worked with, I believe it might have been the state, to develop a small little gravel parking area, and there's a clear signage, there's parking, and I think there's handicap accessible parking there too. And it clearly shows where the easement into the town owned parcel is. So that was one where we were a little bit more forward thinking in how we purchased the land. We actually bought that land with CPA funds too. So we used part of that funding to be able to establish that trailhead. But some of these longstanding conservation parcels that we have were just, people who are citizens just going out there and trying to clear away so that people could gain access to that. And that's, a lot of those are overgrown.
Yeah, they really are. Yeah.
And signage is missing too. You have a lot of areas.
It doesn't have the signage, but there was nothing else beyond the signage. Yeah. In the parking spaces, there were like three parking spaces there.
Yeah, right. And in some parcels, we purchased them, like Driftway Farm. We purchased that. The idea was to put a parking area in a very small parking area, HP parking, and signage, but just never seemed to happen.
Yeah.
Maybe what we need is a outside consultant that can look at the big picture and say, well, here's what your goals were. You had an open space plan. Maybe this is what you need to start doing.
You're really close to taking the Georgetown Riley State Forest and going to the greenway that we're doing now on East Main Street. You're almost touching, but you have to find a way to bridge those. Now you can go from the Georgetown Riley State Forest to the greenway. You get to the greenway, now you can almost go to the Cranes Wildlife Refuge if you go down the power lines, and there's a certain couple bottlenecks there. But if you can straighten those out, you now go from all the way from the Cranes Wildlife Refuge to the Greenway to Georgetown Riley State Forest, Cleveland Farm Road, there's a to Willowdale, all the way to Hamilton, and it's all protected. It's a trail that's all can all be marked, but there's a couple of bottlenecks that just have to be straight on, and some of it is just swampland that somebody owns, but it's not buildable. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So there's a couple, you know, someone who can look at the plot plans and look at potential easements, and if you can buy three or four easements, you now got a connectivity from Hamilton all the way to Groveland, which would be nice if you're for the future, you know. Yeah. And then you can work on the trails and the mapping and those thing type of things.
It's all about the future.
Well, like I said, some of it is.
Well, we need to do the thinking today.
I mean, they're talking about the future when 15 years ago when they talked about the rails trail, and that's coming in 3 years, right? So
it takes a long time.
You know, things take a long time. You got to work on them.
But that's an opportunity for connecting the open space.
Yes.
Right? Because as you say, I mean, it touches on state lands, it touches on the Crane Wildlife Management Area, and it
helps connectivity.
Right through town. That's right through downtown. We've got some open space areas that can get through that way.
Touches Camp Denison.
So I think that
it's all part of it.
So there you go. That's a greenway, a corridor in and of itself.
Yeah, I mean, it's an excellent model for volunteerism over there too. I mean, a good group over there.
Oh, Camp Denison, yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
really.
Yep.
Okay.
To segue from that, we have a little bit of a summary of the appropriations that we'll be recommending town meeting. It talks about the ramp. We've discussed all these all tonight. There's a summary for everybody moving forward with it. That completes the presentation for 2016 CPC recommended projects. Did I see a hand?
I do have a question. You get 10%, you said, of the taxes, right?
Negative. No, I don't. If I said that, I misspoke.
No, so when this goes to the town and recommended, I thought that there was a certain amount of money that was set aside that was from the taxes.
The way this works, we have the local revenues from after your first $100,000 of the taxes. It's a 3% surcharge after the first $100,000.
Okay.
That's the local revenues. Because we're at 3%, then the state comes in, and the state has the Community Preservation Trust. They do annual dispersals of money in three rounds. We get matched. This year we're at about 49%, and we get three rounds of distributions from the state because we're at 3%. That's an incredibly complex decile-based formula from the state. You're welcome to read about it on the website. I can't even begin to describe it to you. But the bottom line is we get state matched from the monies. And when I said the 10%, sir, what I was referring to is out of the state money and local money, once that's all combined, the law says that we must take 10% of that amount and either spend it or reserve it for community housing. We must take another 10% and spend it or reserve it for historic purposes, and another 10% that has to be reserved or spent every year on open space and recreation. We must do that every year. The remaining 70% you can spend in any of the categories.
I guess that was my question. You must know what that amount is that you're getting for the year.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So my question is, when you listed all those things, I didn't see a total. And then I was kind of wondering, where are we with that figure? And then what happens to any excess of that? Is that carried over?
Yeah, absolutely. The excess of that goes in what we call the undesignated funds.
You have money from the past that is being carried over?
Yes, we have reserves that carried over because we had reserve monies that carry into the community housing fund, to monies that went into the historic fund and monies that were reserved left over that went into the open space and recreation category.
So do you have a place where you can see what?
On the webpage.
I mean, I was just curious. I mean, do you have like $2 million set aside somewhere, you know, and whatever? And
yeah.
Like Camp Denison, you know, they only want to do some more, but I mean, they do want to do more. And I thought, well, if there's some more money there, can we allocate more for that? Because they can finish the project?
Yeah, I think this year's appropriation, I think that the recommended appropriations left us, I want to say, with $4,000. I thought it was like $4,000.
Yeah.
Something like that.
We pretty much used everything up this year.
Yeah, we used just about everything.
Well, that's what I was curious about, because it doesn't show
right, there were some years we carried over much more.
Last year we did.
Yeah.
Just to say, much of the funds are also designated. So there may be, like the rail trail, that there's a lot of money that is sitting there and does collect some interest, but that's designated
that's
funds.
That's already been appropriated.
Yeah, so you can't take that for something else.
Well,
you're talking about monies that haven't been, right?
For Rock Pond and for Pawtucket Pond, I mean, you know, that money was set aside.
That was appropriated previously.
That's what happened earlier.
But I was just curious, because when we vote on all those things, I was thinking, gee, are we in that budget or not? You know,
Definitely within the budget. Don't worry. But yeah, one of the things we don't go over the budget. The one time that we had to go over the budget, it resulted in $1 million bond. That was for the turf, the AstroTurf over at the high school. That was when we were over budget. We had to do it that way. That went towards the $1 million for the AstroTurf and $130,000 for
And we're paying on that every year through the revenues that we get from the Community Preservation Act.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. And we'll be putting $150,000 towards it. We're asking the town to put $150,000 from the available monies we had this year, total receipts, $150,000 towards that to help pay the debt service.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. Glad for the question. Yeah. That completes the presentation. Community Preservation Committee wishes to thank you. Don't forget, show up at the May Town Meeting, Monday, May 2nd. And if you have any more questions, georgetowncpc.com.
So those people up in Andover that horse farm, they can't get to.
There's a lot of information there. I think if you look around and you look, dig in there, and I think you'll find everything you want to find out. You got to dig, though. You got to really drill.
Which is my property. You do.
Thank you.
This is a hearing you just closed.
Absolutely. Let me hop over here.
Because if the guy sold, and ride the horses around the fence, but they can't sell.
Yeah, that's not great.
Well, I would think it would help.
Can I just ask you 1 second? Motion to close the hearing?
Second.
Motion to close. The hearing by Gary, seconded by Peter.
It's all part of a big picture.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries unanimously.
But the people across the street, there's a potential way to get out to the...
Hearing is hereby adjourned at, 9:25, right?
Yeah. And they're trying to fix it up.
Thank you very much, everybody. Don't forget, May 2nd, annual town meeting. Be there, please.
No. Yeah.